Please join me in welcoming Erica Hirshler.
Thank you all so much for being here today. It's a great pleasure for me to share this exhibition with you. I'm going to make one more plea that everybody turn off their thing, because I tend to lose my train of thought when they go off, and we wouldn't want that to happen, because God knows what I would say. Many of us have long been attracted to Sargent's watercolors. They're so beautiful and seemingly effortless. Sargent's friend and his first biographer, a man named Evan Charteris, wrote that to live with Sargent's watercolors is to live with sunshine captured and held. And it's easy to see why when we look at works like this one from Brooklyn's collection, Gourds, painted in Mallorca in 1908, which, more than anything, really, is about the fall of light as it flickers through leaves and vines and shapes these heavy gourds, which are actually an edible variety that was once a staple on the island. But the watercolor is about so much more than these gourds. It's really about paint and painting, which were, of course, Sargent's favorite obsession. We see in it his mastery of the complex techniques of watercolor, wet washes that bleed together to form the round shapes of these heavy gourds, the way he added opaque paint to clear color, or used a glaze of thin, transparent color over opaque white to add substance to his forms and to give a sense of the dusty dryness of the thick foliage. The light areas of reserve that we see in particular on the necks of the gourds, reserve being areas that were left entirely unpainted, allowing the white paper to become the brightest highlights, the bright sunlight falling on the gourds. And the gestural strokes of dry paint pulled across the composition to give a sense of the tangled vines. This composition is also unusual because it has no real focus. Your eye travels freely across the surface of the paper. Well, who was the man who made this incredible object? Who was Sargent after the turn of the 20th century? I'm showing you here a self-portrait that was made in 1907 that belongs to the Uffizi Museum in Florence. And I want to talk a little bit about where Sargent was at the time he made the watercolors that are in the exhibition, picking up a little bit on what Pat Hill spoke to you about last week. This is not the artist that we're used to thinking about. This is not the Sargent who painted works like these, our own Daughters of Edward Darley Boyd from 1882 on the left, and the Metropolitan Museum's portrait of Madame X on the right from 1883. These great portraits, the ones that we associate so much with Sargent and his career, were now 20 years in the past. Sargent had been a young man in his 20s, seeking to make a name for himself in Paris when he painted these pictures. Now he was in his early 50s, an established portraitist, acclaimed on both sides of the Atlantic. But in a way, Sargent had now become the victim of his own success. His commissions became increasingly aristocratic. Here's one from exactly the turn of the last century. This is Lord Dalhousie from 1900 in a private collection. This is the 22-year-old Earl Arthur Ramsay, set in a classical stage setting with assured elegance in that pristine white suit and a certain amount, I think you'll agree, of arrogance. Just a little, especially to us Americans. Dalhousie is presented here as a worthy heir to his ancestors, who hung on the same stairway in their manor house as this portrait would be installed, and in fact, still is. Equally, Sargent positioned himself as a worthy heir to artists like Van Dyck, the greatest portraitist of the 17th century, and I'm showing you here for comparison Van Dyck's The Lords John and Bernard Stuart from about 1630 in the National Gallery in London, and I think I don't need to point out to you how many things Sargent borrowed from his predecessor. So not only is Arthur Ramsay presented as the heir to a great tradition of British aristocracy, but Sargent himself presented himself as an heir to a great British tradition of portraiture. Well, that idea sounded good for a long time, but then there were more and more and more commissions like this. Here are two more on the left. Winifred, the Duchess of Portland from 1902 on the left, and on the right, Sir Frank Swettenham from 1903. Winifred Cavendish Bentinck, the Duchess of Portland, was a prominent society figure and a charitable philanthropist after she married the Duke of Portland in 1889. On the right, Swettenham was the resident general of the British colonies in Malaysia, and he's shown with all of the paraphernalia of that office. These are really official portraits, portraits with their own rules and demands. And the portrait commissions like these not only fit into a continuum of aristocratic portraits of power, they also became more and more demanding, as Pat Hills began to tell you last week. More demanding and more aristocratic. On the left, our own Charles Stuart, the Marquess of Londonderry, in the position of honor that he held during the coronation of King Edward VII in 1902, holding the great sword of state. On the right, Charles, the 9th Duke of Marlborough, with his wife and their two sons, or as they sometimes put it, the heir and the spare. Well, everybody had an awful lot to live up to. Stuart to his illustrious ancestors, and I'm showing you on the right Sargent's portrait in the position that he originally held in Londonderry House on London's Pall Mall, a house that no longer exists. But you can see that Sargent's portrait fit in with a whole suite of portraits lining this long hallway and in fact held a very important position of honor. So Sargent had to live up to his artistic ancestors, just as Charles Stuart had to live up to his own ancestors. And I'm showing you at the lower right an example of both of these things. The 3rd Marquess of Londonderry at the lower right, painted by the British portraitist Sir Thomas Lawrence. So it's what Sargent had to live up to, and also Charles Stuart's position to live up to his illustrious ancestor, the soldier and diplomat who served under the Duke of Wellington. This, too, was a lot to live up to, and the connections were very direct. As I said, these paintings were often made for the greatest aristocratic houses, and Sargent's portrait of the Duke and Duchess of Marlborough are still at Blenheim, one of the largest and most elaborate houses that you can possibly visit, which I show you here on the right, outside in all of its glory, and inside with the Sargent portrait in context. Charles was the 9th Duke of Marlborough. His wife was an American, Consuelo Vanderbilt. She provided him with two sons and a big bank account. This was not a love match, as Consuelo freely admitted in her memoirs, published quite a bit later in a wonderful book, Tell All, after their divorce, called The Glitter and the Gold. He was the glitter, she was the gold. But these are really official portraits. They're much less about the personalities of these people than about their position. And this painting is an unabashed and undisguised proclamation of dynasty. The son dressed in gold and white at the center is John, who was the Marquess of Blandford and the much desired heir. He stands directly beneath the portrait bust of the first Duke of Marlborough, and he grasps his father's sword, accepting the transfer of authority that was embodied in that ancestral symbol of power. Well, pictures like these are very interesting art historically, and they're often done with passages of great beauty, but you can't think that they provided Sargent with much artistic freedom. The genre was too tightly controlled, especially in this case, where Sargent had been commissioned to respond specifically to an 18th century portrait by Sir Joshua Reynolds that I show you here on the right of the fourth Duke of Marlborough from 1778, a painting also still in the collection at Blenheim. Sargent at first demurred, worrying that the massive scale of the required canvas would be too large for his subjects. When he realized there was no choice, recounted the Duchess, he began to study a composition that would place us advantageously in architectural surroundings. Well, soon the orders for portraits like this began to seem endless. This is Max Beerbohm's cartoon of Sargent's studio at 31 Tite Street in London. There's Sargent peeking out the window in horror at the endless line of duchesses who are coming to have their portraits painted, accompanied by their liveried footmen. Well, you can imagine that portraits like this became very rote for Sargent, and particularly boring. He felt he had nothing creative to say with them anymore. And to his friend William Rathbone, he wrote that the antidote to this kind of portrait painting was to be found in watercolors. With his watercolors, Sargent said, he would be able to prove to himself and to others that I am not a duffer. Sargent added that he found he especially needed the relief they could provide, and I quote, when such things occur as Lord Londonderry and 9 portraits out of 10, these sketches, by which Sargent meant his watercolors, keep up my morale. Well, Sargent was also somewhat less in need of the income that these portrait commissions provided. For one thing, he made a lot of money as a portrait painter, which he invested wisely with Lee Higginson in Boston, in case you're wondering. And he also had another source of income by this point. Since 1890, he had a steady commission at the Boston Public Library for a series of murals that I show you here. On the left, Sargent Hall in the third floor of the McKim Building at the Boston Public Library, and on the right, a detail of the barrel vault here at the so-called pagan end of this hallway that was about the history of religion. Sargent received the commission in 1890 and was thrilled with it, and in fact, you should know that it kept him busy for the rest of his career, and in fact, it was never completed. The pagan end that I'm showing you here was installed in 1895, but he kept working on it, on the lunettes and on the Christian end which I don't have a slide to show you of, which was installed much later. And then still after that, these large paintings on the wall. And I hope you can see just at the edge of this slide that this picture is blank. In fact, Sargent never finished the commission. That was meant to be a scene of the Sermon on the Mount, the crowning statement of this history of the religion cycle, but in fact, Sargent never finished it. But because of his idea for the Sermon on the Mount and his ideas for the murals at the BPL altogether, Sargent began to travel much more widely and to paint more frequently in watercolor. And medium he had used occasionally since childhood, but which he used with ever-increasing frequency during the 1890s. I'm showing you here two examples of watercolors, both from the Metropolitan Museum's collection at the top. On the left, some angels in the Palatine Chapel mosaic at Palermo in Sicily, made in 1897 about. And on the upper right, a Tiepolo ceiling in Milan, painted about the same time. And I show them to you to point out that Sargent went all over the place to study the great decorative cycles of the past, religious and otherwise, Byzantine mosaics in Sicily, in Venice, and elsewhere, or the great cycles of the Baroque and the Renaissance, including a number of Tiepolo ceilings like the one you see on the right. He wanted to know how artists filled these big spaces, what kind of decorative motifs they used to frame them, and lots of ideas from these different cycles show up in the Boston Public Library murals. He also began to become more interested in the Middle East, and at the bottom you see an oil landscape made in 1905 of Mar Saba, one of the more unusual landscapes in Palestine, which Sargent visited in 1905. And I show it to you to point out that the watercolors in the exhibition coincide with oil paintings that show a lot of the same places and same scenes. Sargent never gave up painting in oils. Just because our show concentrates on the watercolors doesn't mean there aren't related works in oil. In fact, Sargent, during the 1890s, returns to a pattern that he had practiced since the beginning of his career, something that Pat Hills talked about a little bit last week. He went outside of the studio during the summer to sketch and paint in the countryside, gathering materials for large compositions in oil. The painting at the top, the MFA's Oyster Gatherers at Cancale, which you heard about last week, was made in 1878. The one at the bottom of the screen, called On His Holidays, was made in 1901. And you can see that Sargent is returning to this idea of painting figures out of doors, getting different perspectives, a more relaxed point of view maybe, an outdoor brilliance that he was unable to achieve in the studio. Well, On His Holidays was painted in Norway, where Sargent went on a fishing expedition with friends in 1901. And during this point, he starts to make sketches not just in oil, as they had been earlier in his career, but now in watercolor. And the watercolors were more than sketches. Sargent began to conceive of them as independent works of art and not simply studies for his oil compositions. I'm showing you on the left again the big oil On His Holidays, which is at the Lady Lever Art Gallery in Britain. And on the upper right, one of the watercolors in the exhibition, the Salmon River, painted, it's the same river, which I think you can just make out, which is in the exhibition, now in Brooklyn's collection. And at the lower right, a more sketchy watercolor of fishes in a private collection. Sargent, as I said, began to conceive of his watercolors as independent works of art, and those who saw them admired them very much. But Sargent was never interested in parting with them. Or as he said again to William Rathbone, "These sketches keep up my morale and I never sell them." He did, however, begin to consider exhibiting them, perhaps in part in response to the pleading of people like Rathbone or friends of his who ran art galleries. In May 1903, Sargent had his first ever solo show of any kind in London at the Carfax Gallery, a project that he had undertaken perhaps as a favor to friends. I'm showing you here Sargent's studio on Tite Street in the center of the composition and the group that was affiliated with the Carfax Gallery. The Carfax was a gallery that favored modern British and occasionally French artists, and it had been founded just in 1898 by three young men, one of whom was William Rothenstein, who you see here at upper left in a pencil, a drawing that became a lithograph by Sargent. And I'm showing you Rothenstein's pencil drawing of Sargent at lower left. Rothenstein and Sargent were friends and neighbors on Tite Street in London's Chelsea neighborhood and had been since 1893, 10 years before the gallery was made. In 1901, the daily operations at the Carfax Gallery were taken over by Moore Addy and Robert Ross, and I'm showing you Robert Ross here in a photograph at upper right. And Sargent knew Ross as well. Ross was best known today as one of Oscar Wilde's lovers, his devoted friend, and his literary executor. But he was also an important gallerist and art critic who often praised Sargent in the press. And in fact, Sargent gave Ross a small bronze version of his crucifixion, which you see here at right. There's several bronze versions of this. You might know that a larger version of it anchors the Christian end of the Boston Public Library. It was Ross who was the organizer of Sargent's three shows at the Carfax Gallery in London in 1903, in 1905, and in 1908, all of which included Sargent's watercolors. There were 12 in the show in 1903, including this one, From a Gondola, 1903, now in Brooklyn's collection. They were a star attraction, as the critic Charles Lewis Hind declared in a magazine called Academy and Literature. The six Venetian watercolors that Sargent showed were, quote, swagger watercolors. And he said that these broad, splashy studies vivified his own memories of Venice in a manner that he would have thought impossible. Other London critics were equally enthusiastic, praising Sargent's vigorous appeal and masterly brevity. While there was only one voice of dissent in Sargent's early exploration of watercolor, and they all those voices came from one man, Roger Fry, who is an art teacher, historian, and a columnist in the London press, who would, over the next several years, establish himself as Sargent's chief critical antagonist and aesthetic adversary. In an unsigned review, Fry commented on the informality of Sargent's display, and he claimed that he preferred Sargent, and I quote, "on parade at the Academy," meaning in portraits, "rather than in undress at the Carfax." He called Sargent's watercolors crude. He decried their stark juxtapositions of complementary colors, and he declared that the scenes Sargent represented were in keeping with the most ordinary views admired by any conventional tourists. That's a criticism that I'd like you to keep in mind, because it's something that the modernists kept saying and kept saying and kept saying about Sargent's work throughout the 20th century, and it's only recently that Sargent's watercolors have begun to come into their own. Although Fry admitted that Sargent was a skilled practitioner, he grumbled that even with Sargent's keen powers of observation, that he failed to capture the spirit, the atmosphere, or the poetry of place. Hard to believe, unless you figure out that Fry had his own exhibition at the Carfax Gallery in April 1903, right before Sargent's. On the left, again, Sargent's From the Gondola from 1903. On the right, a watercolor a little bit later because I couldn't find an earlier one. This is Roger Fry's Facade of Chartres Cathedral from 1906. On the right, from the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Of course, Fry's assessment of Sargent's watercolors is consistent with his opinions about Sargent's portraits and with his more general commentaries on artistic practice, especially some years later when Fry becomes a vociferous supporter of the post-impressionists and the modernists. But I really do think that these early comments about Sargent's watercolors have personal significance. You can see how different their approach is here. While Fry maintains a typically British traditional approach to watercolor with pen outlines carefully delineating the architecture filled in by broad translucent washes of color, you can see how different Sargent's are, especially in the one on the right, which has no outlines whatsoever, but simply seems to appear on this wet paper as if it were a mirage. Well, Sargent continued slowly to put his watercolors before the public. He showed five at the Royal Society of Painters and Watercolors in the summer of 1904, including this one called Gondolier Siesta, which is also in the show. The Royal Society had been founded in 1804, and it was integral to the establishment of watercolor as a British national tradition, a source of pride that at the turn of the 20th century, and on the occasion of the Society's centenary, looked back to the achievements in watercolor of Turner, of Bonington, and of other heroes of the British school. As I said, the convention called for carefully delineated, composed, panoramic landscapes enlivened with transparent washes of color. How utterly different Sargent's works must have appeared with their broad, dense strokes, their loosely defined forms, and their ostensibly casual compositions. The liberal newspaper, the Westminster Gazette, compared Sargent's arrival at the Royal Society exhibition to that of an eagle in a dove coat, conjuring a pretty compelling image of the painter's bold command of watercolor and the unsettling effect that it must have had on the more conventional and perhaps more timid or dove-like practitioners. His watercolors, Sargent's watercolors, the writer continued, with their vehement vitality and swift assurance, serve to reduce their immediate neighbors on the wall to paper. The critic for the Art Journal declared that Sargent's watercolors were a bewilderment to men of the older, more staid school. And you can see that in Sargent's view of Venice on the screen before you, which employs a low, uneven vantage point that clearly originated from the seat of a gondola. It's an intimate, water-bound scene in which the viewer is closely linked to the resting oarsmen, sharing their perspective and position at the base of an age-stained palace. We don't know, really, that this palace happens to be on the Grand Canal. Sargent doesn't show you any of that splendid waterway, instead giving you just a piece, a glimpse of a little bit of an unidentifiable palace. Although it includes a few preliminary strokes of pencil and some later enhancements in ink and in white gouache, Gondelier's Siesta is composed almost entirely of broad and mottled washes of black and brown and green and ochre that gain in substance from the very toothy, rough texture of the paper that shows through these colors. The reviewer for the Globe in London recognized the skill that went into works like this, noting that Sargent's seeming carelessness of touch is really controlled by the most correct judgment and the acutest perception in relations of tone and color. Well, soon Sargent was displaying works in London in watercolor regularly, but his paintings were never for sale. At the Watercolor Society, they might be marked sold, he told Rathbone, but they're not really for sale. As the popular British writer Edward Lucas would describe it, Sargent's watercolors, and I quote, were not to be obtained for love or money, but they fall to the lot of such of his friends as wisely marry for them as wedding presents, or tumble out of his gondola and need consolation. Well, among the friends who became acutely aware of Sargent's accomplishments in watercolor was Edward Darley Boit. And I'm showing you here Sargent's portrait of Boit on the left, made in 1908, included in the exhibition. And of course, he knew Boit for a very long time. You might remember the painting on the right from 1882, which shows Edward Boit's four daughters. In 1907, Ned Boit convinced Sargent to paint his portrait, as Ned's brother Robert recounted in his diary, and I quote, John Sargent has painted no portraits, or practically none, for the last year or two. He had grown stale, as they say, and had the strength to refuse all orders for portraits and to turn for the rest to landscape. Well, when the question arose of painting Ned, he said he should be delighted that Boit portraits had always brought him luck. So Ned is to sit for him shortly after he gets to England. Sargent said, I'm so afraid you'll be disappointed and that I can't do anything as great as what you have of me already. He did have a nice portrait, one must admit. Well, Ned Boit arrived in London early in April 1908 and sat for the portrait. Sargent says mine is the last portrait he shall ever paint, related Ned to his brother. He's been doing wretched work, he says, and that an artistic portrait, such as he knows I must want, is no longer in his power. However, having had me in a dozen poses and lights, he got me, by means of screens and mirrors, into an effect that he said interested him to paint. Well, you can only imagine, while all of this arranging and mirrors and screens was going on, that Boit might have seen some of Sargent's watercolors in Sargent's studio, where they were said to lay, and according to one observer, around in great drifts and piles. Boit would have been interested. He was a painter himself and particularly active as a watercolorist. I'm showing you here on the left his daughter Julia. She's the little one sitting on the floor in the portrait. She became a watercolorist too. And on the left, you see her portrait of her father painting by the work, One Will Know the Artist, is what it says in the upper right-hand corner. And on the right, two watercolors by Boit himself, the Place de l'Opéra from the MFA's collection at upper right, and a view of Biarritz from 1893, recently on the art market. If you want to pick up a bargain, Boit's work is available. Here, as you can see, Boyd had a long relationship with watercolor, working from a sort of tight style in the 1880s. And by the way, his watercolor at upper right was shown in the same salon exhibition that Sargent showed the portrait of the Boyd girls in 1883. And at lower right, working into a looser, more transparent, washy style, more typical of his late work. And it was Boyd who pushed and prodded Sargent into the idea of showing his watercolors in the United States, all of which is documented in recently discovered materials. I'm showing you the Boyd portrait by Sargent again on the left, and on the right, the documents that I've also borrowed from the Massachusetts Historical Society to include in the exhibition. That's volume 14 of Robert Boyd's diary held by the MHS. You can imagine, because I read all 14 volumes, I want you to know, but I was pretty tired by the time I got to 1908 and volume 14. But when I flipped over that page and saw letters from Sargent that no Sargent scholar had seen before, I got pretty excited. And I'm showing you one of them on the lower part of the right-hand screen. The black and white photograph at upper right is a view of the Knoedler Gallery in New York in the early 20th century. So Boyd wanted to have joint watercolor exhibitions with Sargent, and pushed and prodded and wrote and begged. Sargent resisted. Exhibiting them would hardly be worth the trouble, he said in this 1908 letter that you see here on the screen. It was not that Sargent felt his watercolors were inferior works. He knew they were good, but the logistics, the mechanics, the risks and costs of arranging for shipments of works of art from London to the United States seemed to be to him too much of a burden, and the result of his efforts would only lead to more bother. If I appear in America in the light of a watercolor painter, Sargent said, I shall be written to perpetually from different exhibitions all over the country to exhibit, which would mean a lot of useless correspondence. The only way to avoid going mad would be to send them all over in bond and have them back again without selling any at all. Well, Boyd finally talked Sargent into doing the show, and it's important to remember that they were joint shows. And Knoedler and Company in New York, which was a gallery that until fairly recently, if you've been following the news, specialized both in old masters and in contemporary art, accepted the proposal to have the show in 1909, writing to Boyd, we hasten to say that we shall be pleased to make a joint exhibition of your watercolors with those of Mr. John S. Sargent. Our commission, in case of sale, would be 20%. Otherwise, nothing. The show was scheduled to open on February 15th and to close on January 27th, 1909. And I'm showing you here the catalog for the exhibition and the announcement of the opening. The show then traveled on to Boston, where Ned and Robert Boyd secured the skylit gallery of the Boston Art Club in the city's Back Bay, where the show was seen from March 25th to April 10th. And there's a little card there announcing it at the Boston Art Club. I'm showing you at the upper right, a Boyd of Biarritz from the MFA's collection from 1893 that was included in that show, and on the lower right, Sargent's view of Venice, La Riva, from the Brooklyn collection, which was also in the exhibition. On February 12, 1909, Robert and Ned Boyd took the 10 o'clock train from Boston to New York to install the exhibition. The show was installed on the evening of February 13th. I read this to our installation crew. We began to hang at 6:20 and got through it a little after 8. Pretty rapid work, as we had about 146 pictures to hang. but I never saw such a hard-working lot of picture hangers as Nodler had on hand. Of course, we had to select and group properly, and the result was charming, filling both galleries. Sargents were wonderful in the accuracy and freedom of drawing and wealth of color, a truly marvelous lot of work with every variety of subject. One felt that he had sketched what he loved and what he loved to sketch. Sargent advised by mail on the installation, writing to the boys that they should keep the series together, the subjects together, and that the Arab works would form the pièce de résistance of the display. And the show was a sensation. "Only a man of genius could have done this work," said Royal Cortesos in the New York Herald Tribune. Arthur Hober, in another magazine, called Sargent's watercolors a delightful surprise. They carry you off your feet. The American Art News said, "They are virile in execution and strong, beautiful, and rich in color." There seemed to be no dissenting opinions. Bob Boyd noted that some days the crowd was so great one could not get into Nodler's shop. We can only hope the same holds true here. Still, the works were not for sale. "I really do not care to sell them, at any rate, not piecemeal," Sargent wrote. "If by any chance some Eastern museum or some Eastern collector wanted to buy the whole lot en bloc, I might consider it." The watercolors, Sargent said, only amount to anything when taken as a lot together. Bob Boyd said in his diary, "Sargent said in one of his letters to Ned that he would only be willing to sell his watercolors in a block to some museum or Eastern collector. Afterwards, he cabled that he would not sell." Acting, however, on his first letter, Nodler notified the various museums in the East of the pictures and advised them to make an offer for them. And the museum that leapt at the opportunity was the Brooklyn Museum, then under the direction of this man, A. Augustus Healy, who made an offer for the whole group within 2 days. And there were 83 watercolors. This is Sargent's portrait of Healy, also from 1907 in the exhibition. Healy had been a successful leather merchant, and he was an astute collector. See him again here at upper right, with Sargent's 1907 self-portrait at the lower right. Healy and Sargent knew one another. Healy had posed for his portrait in 1907, and he owned one of Sargent's most recent painting, Dolce Far Niente, which you see at lower left. Healy was also one of a number of museum executives with whom Sargent had worked to place significant works of art in American public collections. Sargent's enthusiasm for the French artist James Tissot's monumental watercolor series, The Life of Christ, helped Healy raise funds for its acquisition in 1900. And I'm showing you here at the top left, one of the Tissots, Jesus Goes Up Alone to the Mountain to Pray, from 1886. The series was made over about 10 years, and now is all in the Brooklyn Museum. Well, Healy completed the deal for the Sargents swiftly, and Brooklyn became the first American museum to own Sargent's watercolors, all a group of relatively recent works that Sargent himself had selected to display his talents. Among the highlights of the Brooklyn collection are remarkable views of Venice, like these two, Santa Maria della Salute from 1904 on the left, and the Bridge of Sighs on the right from, we're not sure, 1903, 1904 on the right. They show a great range of finish, from summery sketches broadly painted, like the one on the right, to complex, detailed compositions that are carefully anchored by pencil underdrawing, such as the one you see on the left. Sargent painted the Salute repeatedly, and Brooklyn's is one of a series that show only a little bit of that grand church that anchors the end of the Grand Canal, most often shown in panoramic views, but never in Sargent's, never Does he show the whole thing? Instead, only a fragment of it. And in the galleries, you'll see that we've paired the Brooklyn Santa Maria della Salute with one from the MFA's collection, almost the same, but slightly different in point of view. On the right, one of the most famous sites in Venice, the Bridge of Sighs, that famous Baroque bridge, shimmers in white marble. It has pilasters, grillwork, carved heads, exuberant scrolls, but it's almost blank the way Sargent shows it. A negative space left vacant while the brilliant blue of the sky was painted in above and below it. Sargent added a few broad washes of brown to give the structure some sense of three-dimensionality, but really it just appears to dissolve into the bright sun. And he took less care to delineate the Bridge of Sighs than he took to depict the slight skew of the prow of his own gondola, which he typically included in the composition rather than editing it out. And of course, great care to depict the live bodies of the gondoliers and their parasoled passengers who pass at the right. The energy of this watercolor lies not in the monuments of the past, but instead in the sun-drenched views of modern life. Another highlight of Brooklyn's collection are the Arab series, which you see in one gallery in the exhibition, including this highlight of two Bedouin men. These watercolors were the products of Sargent's five-month visit to Syria, Lebanon, and Palestine from September 1905 to January of 1906, taken in very close connection with the Boston Public Library murals. He concentrated his attention in watercolor on the nomadic Bedouins who live near El Ghor, the geographical depression that forms the lower part of the Jordan Valley. One writer described Sargent's watercolors like these as spoil from the sun-drenched east, whose intensity does not subjugate or even bewilder Mr. Sargent. Also a highlight of Brooklyn's collection, these wonderful views of ships in Mediterranean seas, where the fluid medium of watercolor seems so well suited to these outdoor representations of boats on the water. Melon Boats at the bottom of the composition is believed to depict a scene in Haifa. Its radically cropped and close-up view gives just a fragment of this cluster of craft moored together on the water. At the top, one of my favorites, white ships, again made in Mallorca, with dazzling light and color reflecting off of the white-bellied boats, again rafted together on the surface of crystalline Mediterranean waters. It doesn't really matter where Sargent is for these pictures. It's the quality of light that attracts his attention. Well, Boyd was so thrilled with the success of the exhibition that he immediately made plans for a second display. And the second joint exhibition was slated to take place in the winter or spring of 1912, but it was already confirmed by Knoedler in October 1910. Sargent was typically self-deprecating. He said he didn't think he had anything good to show, and so he went off to make some watercolors for the exhibition. From Samplon in 1911, and you see Sargent painting at the Samplon on the left in a wonderful photograph that one writer described as looking like a chicken who'd hatched out of an egg. From Samplon in August 1911, Sargent wrote to Bob Boyd, "I have been hard at work trying to turn out watercolors for the next tournament with Ned. I probably won't have as good a show this time. The last lot were the pick of 10 years or more." By November, he was in Carrara, scribbling a postcard to Ned Boyd. "My dear Boyd," he wrote, "I'm just packing up to go back to London. Have been working hard, especially at watercolor, on account of our show, but my contribution will be less important than the last, I fear. I have spent a month way up in the mountain in the middle of the quarries. very fine, but very rough living. Well, I think you can get a hint of that from the watercolor at the upper right by Sargent and the photograph taken either by Sargent or by his manservant of the quarryman at Carrara at about the same time at lower right. At this point, Sargent knew that he was painting for the Boston Museum, which had prearranged to buy all the watercolors from the second exhibition. Since our offer arrived too late after the Brooklyn deal was signed, and you won't be surprised to find out that we offered a little bit less than Brooklyn did. So the second set of watercolors was crafted in large part with the exhibition in mind. They're much more public in character, tapping more qualities that are characteristic of Sargent's public performances in oil, and I'll talk about that in a second. As I said, by the time the second show opened in March 1912, all the watercolors had been purchased by the MFA. And in a gesture of goodwill for the hometown team, the MFA didn't just buy all the Sargents, like the wonderful view of laundry on the right, but all 38 of Boyd's works as well, like the one on the left of Park Avenue in New York, which I've included in the learning gallery of the exhibition. As I said, the Boston group is different a little bit in character than the Brooklyn group, with larger, more finished presentation pieces, many of them formally signed, and of course from a smaller range in date, since Sargent had already picked out everything he thought was good for the first exhibition. We have a few earlier ones, but not as many as Brooklyn does. The New York Times of the second exhibition proclaimed, "The Knoedler galleries are ablaze with light and color, and tingling with the effervescence of Sargent's dry wit. It is a fine champagne for a connoisseur's dinner." These are some of the highlights of the Boston group. Here, the Villa de Marlia in Lucca from 1910. The Italian garden scenes were spaces with which Sargent was intimately familiar. As his childhood friend Vernon Lee had recalled, she and Sargent had grown up in the Italian gardens during their childhood in Florence. Or as she put it, "We," and I quote, "burned holes in bay leaves with a burning glass until we were expelled as enfants mal élevés by the ferocious French porter of the Medici Gardens." Badly brought up children. Here you see the Villa de Marlia's expansive balustrated pool garden, whose axis terminates in flanking sculptures of recumbent river gods as fountains, which you see here. But Sargent ignores the sweeping perspective and symmetry of the garden, choosing instead to create a sort of sidelong, immediate sense of intimacy and immediacy that you see here, highlighted, I was delighted to discover, by a little family of ducks. I always thought these were reflections in the water, and I was wondering what these little yellow blobs were, and it turns out they're beaks. Sargent was also profoundly inspired by the very strange and dramatic landscape of Carrara. He stayed in a local inn and in a quarry hut there, which a friend described as, and I quote, "so completely devoid of ordinary comforts that his companions, far younger men, fled after a few days, unable to stand the Spartan rigors tolerated by their senior with such serene indifference." Well, as you can see, one of Sargent's favorite artistic pursuits was exploring the play of sunlight on stone, something that was unequaled in these white cliffs at Carrara. Another highlight of the Boston series are these Simplon figure studies made in the Alps in the period 1909 to 11, when Sargent spent the hottest months of the year in a couple of places in the Simplon Pass. He wasn't alone. His sisters, Emily Sargent and Violet Ormond, Violet's family, and several longtime family friends remained with him throughout the expeditions, and other people came and went at various intervals. But despite our ability to recognize several of his models, especially the beautiful Rosemarie, his niece, who you see here, Sargent seldom focused on the individuality of his sitters, even jokingly referring to them as the intertwingles. Well, when we were putting the show together, my co-curator Terry Carbone at the Brooklyn Museum and I, we were well aware of all the wonderful work that has already been done about Sargent and his travels by numerous colleagues who have traced the course of his journeys and what he made when in each location. And so when we were doing the show, we didn't want to totally ignore geography, and you see that we haven't in our galleries of Venice and the Middle East and the Alps. But we were also struck by themes that appealed to Sargent no matter where he was. And that's one of the things we wanted to pull out for audiences of the exhibition. Figures lying down, for example. Here, several examples. Saint-Plon Pass at the top on the left, Violet sleeping at the upper right, and at the lower right, another Swiss view of Sargent's friend Peter Harrison at the lower right. Figures lying down, turned into landscapes, was something that Sargent had been interested in from the very beginning of his career and throughout his entire life. At the top, you see an 1879 view of a little boy lying on the beach at Capri. At the lower left, a study of a model related, perhaps, to the mural cycle here at the MFA. And at the lower right, one of the MFA's later watercolors of two Tommy soldiers during the First World War. All of these sensuous in application of paint, some of them even erotic. The other thing we see throughout Sargent's watercolors is the survival of portraiture in a very different way during his career. The watercolor at left, I think, is one of the most moving in the exhibition. The tramp was shown in the 1908 Carfax Gallery exhibition as the vagrant and was described at the time as a forcible study of the homeless type. The work, in fact, might be linked to Sargent's 1908 painting called The Hermit, which is now in the Metropolitan Museum of Art. We don't know who the model is. It might have been a model. It might have been an unidentified friend who just happened to capture Sargent's attention. This is an amazing watercolor with no pencil drawing underneath whatsoever. It's all done with paint, really capitalizing on Sargent's skill as a portrait painter in oil, but I think all the more lovely for the sense of humanity given in this informal sketch. Or the portrait on the right, the cashmere shawl, showing Sargent's beloved niece Rosemarie, whose distinctive features are delineated in pencil on top of the watercolor with utmost delicacy. The other thing we were interested in was the interrelationship between Sargent's oils and his watercolors. And that's why there are 10 oils in the exhibition from the Brooklyn and Boston collection, because we wanted to explore the way he moved seamlessly between one medium and the other. Here, Dolce Far Niente at the top, and two watercolors made at the same time. On the left, Man Seated by a Stream, one of the few private collection pictures in the show, and on the right, lower right, Brooklyn's Zuleika. Even while evolving technical skill in watercolor, Sargent seems to have stopped thinking as a watercolor painter. He relished the sparkling, translucent effects he could achieve on paper, qualities that are unique to watercolor and impossible to achieve with glutinous, opaque oil paint. But at the same time, his vision in the two media becomes remarkably consistent. There are no subjects that he reserves for one kind of painting or another. The same cropped, tightly focused figure studies and tipped up landscapes appear in both watercolor and in oil. And I show you another example here. On the left, Brook Among Rocks, a watercolor in the MFA's collection, and on the right, the oil Valdosta in Brooklyn's collection. And you'll hear more about Sargent's technical achievements in watercolor and oil in the presentation next week by my colleagues, the conservators Lydia Vox and Annette Manick, Annette part of the team who wrote a technical essay for the exhibition catalog. Sometimes Sargent's subjects seem plucked at nature from nature at random, like these two scenes of an unidentifiable portion of a mountain stream. As I said, painted in watercolor on the left and in oil on the right, but delivering remarkably similar results. As Adrian Stokes, one of Sargent's friends and fellow artists, put it, Sargent's industry was constant. Sometimes he painted in oil, Stokes said, sometimes in watercolor, but always with astonishing vitality. It seems to me that works like this are related very much to works by one of Sargent's friends, a man who you may have heard of named Monet, who was painting water lilies at just the same time, sharing this idea of a tipped-up composition with no horizon line that calls our attention both to the arrangement of forms across the two-dimensional surface of the canvas, as well as a view into the depth of the landscape itself. Also, we occasionally see Sargent using impasto in watercolors, and what you see at lower left is a detail of the watercolor on the right, big, thick globs of paint that's unusual to include in a watercolor painting. And sometimes he leaves areas of the canvas blank, something common in watercolor, but not in oil. But in both media, Sargent applied his paint with equal fluidity and great gestural strokes. He's thinking purely as a painter, working in whatever medium seemed most suitable to him at the time. The exhibition also gives us a chance to look at Sargent at work. This is his view of his sister, Emily Sargent, painting. She was quite an accomplished watercolor painter herself. You see her here with the same equipment that Sargent had, a telescoping portable easel that could be adjusted to rough terrain and folded up and carried around, a portable paint kit, a metal paint box that flipped open to form a palette in the lid, and several brushes. Of course, here's Sargent, who's no doubt sitting with exactly the same equipment, looking at Emily. I wonder whether she's painting him. Here she is, certainly watching him in a photograph made in about 1911. And here, in a wider view, we see Emily dressed in black with her parasol, watching her brother paint. This setup is hardly what I called my lecture. It's hardly what Sargent called watercolor painting, making the best of an emergency. How many of you have tried to paint in watercolor? A few hands go up. It gets out of control really, really fast. The paint dries, it drips, it bleeds one into another, and that's what Sargent meant by making the best of an emergency. But despite this casual litter of supplies strewn across the ground here, you can see that Sargent meticulously constructed this set. He's the director on stage, arranging his models, posing their parasols in the folds of their skirts, situating himself close to the women so that in the watercolor he seems deliberately to look down on them. Here are the photographs, again, enlargements of this wider scene, and if you look carefully, you can see that the picture on Sargent's easel is the MFA's watercolor reading. But look at what Sargent does. His interest in the composition isn't so much these two beautiful women, but the folds of this white skirt, which takes over more than half of the composition. He loves the way light falls on it. He loves to paint white on white, and he turns this skirt into a landscape of hills and valleys that relates completely to other works of white on white that we might more properly call landscapes. And in fact, Sargent's main subject isn't really always the motif in front of him, but the way his subject, whatever it is, catches the light. whether it's the sunstruck quarry at Quarara that you see on the left with its giant glob of paint at the very center of the composition that at a distance resolves into a rubble of rock, or whether it's this statue of Aegea in the Boboli Garden at the right. Again, what he's most interested in is the way his subjects catch the light. Here are two more garden scenes in a Medici villa from 1906 on the left and Daphne from the MFA's collection on the right from about 1910. One painted in Florence, one in Lucca on the right. We see again Sargent's favorite pursuit, the study of sunlight on stone. He doesn't even really paint the statuary at all, just the shadows and sun-struck areas that fall upon it that when taken together reveal the form. And I think you can see that in the detail of the sculpture in the Medici Villa at the right now, where he's not delineating anything of that intricate sculpture, but only the way the light falls upon it. And he found that subject in piles of rock or in the sophisticated architecture of Renaissance Italy, or sometimes in the simplest of subjects, a simple storage shed on the island of Corfu. Sargent never gave up subject matter, as many 20th century artists would do, but he did make paintings that are not only representations of the visible world, but about light itself and the challenge of representing it. You might say that in watercolors like this one, especially, that Sargent's work isn't really about substance at all. He's painting what's not there, the tree we can't see, the shadows we can't touch. Or as Sargent's friend Charteris wrote, to live with Sargent's watercolors is to live with sunshine captured and held. Thank you. Thank you all so much for being here. Since this is a course, I'd be more than happy to start a discussion or to answer any questions you may have. Anybody? There are microphones on the side. It would be helpful if you'd wait for them to arrive so that other people in the audience can hear your questions.
And we also ask that those who are leaving, please do so quietly.
Thank you.
Right here.
Usually watercolors are painted so quickly. Do you have any idea the amount of time he would take on this?
Good question about how long they may have taken Sargent to make. I've been asked this question a lot, and the answer is I think it varies quite a bit. Some of them I think were done very quickly, including probably the one that you see on the screen, because watercolor dries so fast that I think he didn't go back to something like this, but painted it on the spot relatively quickly. And the only description we have of it equates Sargent painting watercolors to watching somebody play the piano. So I think you get a sense that his hands are moving very, very quickly. Now that said, with something like our watercolor of reading of the two women lying, that I showed you the big detail of the skirt. Now that's something that I feel he might have gone back to later after it dried, adding the thicker strokes of impasto onto it afterwards. Now whether he did that outside or in the studio, we just do not know. He did do oil paintings outside. We know it. We're sure of it because at least one of them has a pine needle stuck in the paint. So we don't really know whether he went back inside to work on these further or not. We do know that there are multiple versions of a couple of these watercolors, including our picture of Daphne, the sculpture. And we know that not ours, but one of the three versions of it, one of the others, was made in the studio because Sargent talks about hearing traffic while he's making it.
Thank you very much for your talk. Again, it was a beautiful talk, and
thank
I
you.
Enjoyed it very much. I would like to know an explanation about murals, because my image was always that you drew it on the wall.
Okay.
And yet you were mentioning they were hung in the library.
Yes.
So what...
That's a very good question about how the murals were done. By this point in the 19th century, a lot of murals, even though they might look like fresco painting, like they were done right on the wall, were actually done on canvas. Sargent's were done on canvas at the BPL, at Harvard, here at the MFA. All the BPL murals are actually on canvas. The Puvis de Chavannes are on canvas. The Abbeys are on canvas. And it was a typical 19th century method of doing mural painting. Obviously, it afforded the artist a lot more freedom to be able to work in the studio. They were made on canvas and then permanently applied to the wall. They would paint one side, they would paint the wall with one kind of lead pigment and the back of the canvas with another kind of lead pigment, and then press it against the wall as if it were wallpaper and push all the air bubbles out of it. So you cannot get them off now, but they were not painted in situ.
Yes, I have a question about the two shows with the watercolors. I understand that the MFA bought Boyd's and Sargent's watercolors. What about the Brooklyn Museum? Did they just buy Sargent's?
The Brooklyn Museum only bought Sargent's. They did not buy any Boyd's, but Boyd's sold a lot of watercolors piecemeal in that 1909 exhibition. And his success, actually, at selling in New York and in Boston actually fired him up with enthusiasm, partly because for the first time in a long time, he felt like a professional artist and not just like a gentleman amateur. You know, to have sales, to show your work, really puts you in a different category as a painter. So he was so fired up by that that he was very eager to have that second exhibition.
Thank you.
Could you talk about the watercolor paints that he used and whether it is felt that much fading has occurred over the years?
Okay, very good question. And I hope you're coming next week and we'll also address that to Annette Manick, our conservator. When we started on this exhibition project, we actually expected to see a lot of fading. Those of us who are familiar with Homer's watercolors, which were made, some of them around the same time, know that Homer used a lot of pigments that really did disappear with time. What we discovered was the Sargents aren't that faded. They really aren't. You can tell when you see them, as we like to say, naked in the lab. In other words, without a mat, you can see the very edges that have been protected through the years. And there's much, much less fading in the Sargents than one might expect. What you don't see in Sargent's work that Homer used was a lot of the lake pigments, particularly the reds that fade very easily. And the other advantage, although the watercolors were shown quite a bit when we first acquired them and when Brooklyn first acquired them, they were in museum collections from the very beginning. So they were never in somebody's living room with the sun coming in for decades. So they're in a very good, surprisingly good state of preservation. We did analyze the pigments in particular, and there is a footnote in the technical essay in the catalog that lists them. But again, I hope you'll address that to Annette Manick next week, who knows a lot more about the individual paints than I do.
My question is also one more that's more technical, which is about the wax resist and how he used it, how he decided to use it, how it, the whole
thing. Again, this is probably something that Annette will speak about next week, so I don't want to steal her thunder, but in a nutshell, wax resist is like a crayon that you would use on an Easter egg. So you draw your significant other's name with a big heart around it on the Easter egg, and then you plunk it in the dye and it comes out, and that's what the wax resist does on a watercolor. You can do it either on the blank paper to have white show through, or you can do it on top of a light color and have that show through. Sargent starts to use it about 1908. We know that because it's on only the latest watercolors in the Brooklyn collection, but it's on a lot of the MFAs. And so he seems to have developed that technique over time. And he used it to just capture light and different effects. And I know Annette will talk about that next week.
You touched upon his relationship with the Impressionists, and Monet in particular. While they go on to become painters of paint, and as you said, he maintains he's still that imagery. Is that because he's so confident in what he wants to do and where he wants to go, or is it he just doesn't want to be part of a group?
It's a complicated question. Sargent knew Monet since 1876. They were friends throughout their lives. They are in contact quite a lot in the early 20th century. It's Sargent who helps Monet when Monet comes to London and does all of those bridge pictures on the Thames. They go to Queen Victoria's funeral together, if you can imagine such a thing. So they are quite a bit in touch. Monet arguably never gives up subject matter either. He's always painting his garden. It becomes very, very abstract, but he never gives up subject matter either. Monet is more admired, I would say, by the abstract artists who come later in the century for his freedom of handling in a way that Sargent isn't. Sargent's reputation goes downhill very precipitously after his death, partly because of people like Roger Fry, who tar him with the anti-modernism brush. And there's nothing worse you can be than Victorian and old-fashioned in the modern age. And so Sargent's star really, really sinks. And it only starts to come back in the 1970s and 80s, to be honest with you. There was one show here in Boston in 1956 that was on the centenary of Sargent's birth, but of course it was about Sargent's Boston, and so it was, you know, kind of all about us anyway. And we never liked modern art anyway, so that wasn't a problem. But I think was a lack of really looking at Sargent. What's fascinating to me about these watercolors is the relationship that they have to what's about to happen. Remember that the show is in 1912, the purchase is in 1912, so everything that is in the show was painted in 1911 or before. The Armory show isn't until 1913. It predates all of that. Yes, Picasso was already painting Demoiselle d'Avignon. Yes, if you were in avant-garde circles in Paris, you would have seen it. Most people hadn't. Most people didn't know that that whole move of abstraction was going to take over. In the early years of the 20th century, there are just as many traditional painters as modernists, and nobody knew which direction it was all going to go. If you take early John Marin, for example, and put it next to late Sargent, they're not as far apart as you might think. And it's that tipping point that I find so interesting, the moment when it could have gone either way. And Sargent didn't know that abstraction was going to take over. He doesn't change, as many artists don't change so dramatically late in their careers to give up subject matter. But he was too tied to the portraits, too tied with that vision of Victorian upper class society in people's minds to be taken seriously by anybody who was a modernist. And that lasted for a long time. Does that help?
Yes, that was a wonderful lecture. Thank you. I have an observation about something you called a theme, which was people in repose or lying down, which also seems to me a rather practical choice because they're not wiggling around. And it also fits in with the question about how long a person painted, because that nap on the Alps probably took 45 minutes or an hour, and then they're up again. So it seems to me a perfectly normal thing to do, having painted that way myself.
I think that's an extremely astute observation that's going right into my next lecture. The other thing I would add, though, is in a way it's kind of the anti-portrait. Because, you know, when you have a commissioned portrait, somebody's standing there, you're really directly relating to them, you're trying to catch not only what you see, but what they want to show you. You're upright. It's a very, as I said, it becomes a very particular kind of thing. When you're painting people lying down, unaware of you, it's a very different relationship between you and the sitter. So it's like the anti-relationship. You have no relationship. They don't even know you're there. There might be being painted. So I think that falls into it too. And he really turns them into landscapes, which again is sort of the anti-portrait. That'll be my next lecture, the anti-portrait in Sargent.
And our last question is back here.
Getting back to the Triumph of Religion murals, which many of these were based on, it's often confused me why he was so Judeo-Christian in a time when the MFA was collecting Japan, China. I checked on Wikipedia and John Lafarge was born 20 years earlier than him, and why he would get so baffled that the Jewish community would get so upset and stop him from painting that Sermon on the Mount.
This is a very complicated question to do with the Boston Public Library murals, which, as some of you may know, were not greeted with a lot of enthusiasm by the Jewish community in Boston, who were particularly upset by Sargent's depiction of church and synagogue, which are the two square pictures right over the stairway. The Sermon on the Mount was meant to be the in between those two. And I can give you a couple of observations, but I would also recommend a book to you by Sally Promy that's all about Sargent's Boston murals, called Painting Religion in Public. And it gets much more into the context of religious painting in the late 19th century. I think the fact that Sargent was Judeo-Christian in his point of view is entirely predictable. So was John Lafarge, even though he showed more of Eastern culture in his work and was more influenced by the art of Japan and the Pacific. But Lafarge is Catholic and stays Catholic his whole life. He's not transformed by that. There are some Bostonians, Bigelow among them, the great collector of Japanese prints, who is very influenced by Buddhism and other Eastern philosophies, and that really does become something strong at the end of the 19th century. But for a public commission in a public building, what's incredible is that it has a religious subject at all. And that is part of the controversy, actually, that this was a city library, that it was paid for by tax dollars, you know, all of the things that we're used to hearing about today, did inflect what was going on with the criticism of the library at the time. At the same time, I think Sargent was very blindsided by the criticism in Boston related to those two murals. Those of you who have studied the history of Western art and who spent time looking at the great cathedrals of Europe know that the iconography of church and synagogue is very, very traditional and goes way, way back. And basically, you know, the people who were building the cathedrals could have cared less about the Jews, and they show church triumphant and synagogue blinded. And that iconography is very old, very typical of European, the history of European art. And I don't think Sargent really got how controversial it would be in this country. I think he was a little bit blindsided by that. Does that help? It's a big question. Thank you all so much for coming.